Morning, everyone. A yachtsman lost at sea for a week has had an emotional reunion with his parents back on dry land. For more, we're joined now by TEN's Melinda Nusifora in Sydney. Melinda, Glenn Eye is incredibly lucky to be alive.
He really is, Ron, and that is a fact that's not lost on this brave sailor. He has gone to pains to repeatedly thank everyone who was involved in this rescue mission. Almost 10 water police officers and 2 plane loads of international airline passengers. There was a combination of very strong winds and huge seas, which could have meant that this rescue ended very differently.
From the middle of nowhere to nowhere he'd rather be.
It's incredible to be back. You got no idea of the difference between standing on terra firma and being out there, yeah, in massive seas, not knowing where you are.
With a tearful hug from his parents and a handshake for police, Glenn Eye was finally home. He'd been drifting further and further out to sea after a monster wave snapped his yacht's mast.
The noise is unbelievable. It comes out of nowhere. I smashed my head straight into the roof. It's like one second you're here and the next second you've been rammed into the roof of your house.
The experienced sailor had been travelling along the coast of New South Wales for a week, but on Sunday, bad weather caught him off guard. With no mast and little fuel, his 11-metre yacht was quickly taking on water.
Couldn't understand why I couldn't see the loom, because the loom of Sydney is, you would see from 50 or 60 miles. And you know, after 7 days, I still couldn't see the loom.
He activated his emergency beacon on Tuesday. With some help from passengers on board 2 commercial aeroplanes, rescue crews found him 270 nautical miles off the coast.
I hope I've expressed my gratitude to these guys, yeah. I really do. I've tried to tell all of them that they've been absolutely brilliant, and I appreciate it, more than appreciate it, that they've been absolutely unreal.
But the drama was far from over. Huge seas and strong winds hampered the rescue effort. He didn't make it back onto dry land until early this morning.
Brilliant. I don't think anybody else could have done what he'd done.
You must be so proud.
Extremely.
My prayers have been answered.
To celebrate his safe return, the family says they're heading to a bakery to stock up on some treats.
Water police say that Glenn Eye had all the responsible safety equipment on board, an emergency beacon, life jackets and emergency radios, and the water police say it's these things, this great preparation, that made sure he could help save his own life.
Mel, thank you very much. And not only did he head to the bakery, he's also headed into our studios. I'm very pleased to say that Glenn Eye joins us right here in the studio this morning. Still in the gear you came off the boat in, no shoes, you've just come straight in. I'm so pleased that you've done that. But I think even more pleased, clearly, were your parents to have you back on dry land. Describe that moment, your mum, your dad in tears.
Yes. Look, it's a wonderful relief to come ashore after such an ordeal, yeah? And to meet your parents on the dock is absolutely beautiful. Huh? It's an enormous relief. It's very nice. Thank you to many wonderful people.
You set off 2 weeks ago from Pittwater in Sydney, just going down to Eden, probably a 2-day sail under normal circumstances.
Days, yes, that's right.
2 weeks later, you've turned up.
Yes.
Why did you leave it so long to set off your EPIRB, your emergency beacon?
Right, okay. I got rolled around about 120 miles out to sea, and the mast went over the side and broke into several pieces. It's very important to get rid of the danger of the mast as quick as possible, because the mast over the side of the boat can spear the boat, right? And if it spears the boat, then you'll go down very quickly. So for the first 36 hours, I just got rid of the mast. I cleared the mast and all the rigging, the sails and things, so that the mast wasn't going to send me to the bottom very quickly. Then I bailed the boat out. The boat was half full of water. It took me another day to bail it out. And by that time that the sea had moderated, the storm had moderated a little bit, and I looked at my position. I was about 120 miles off the coast, and I didn't think it was unreasonable that I couldn't make it back to Sydney. So I set about making my way back to Sydney. And after 9 days, there was no loom of Sydney, nothing come up. I realised I must have been in a strong current.
Yeah.
And I set off I activated the EPIRB.
What did you have to gauge where you were? Were you working off GPS?
I had nothing. Look, 24 hours before I was rolled, I had a position, which I marked on the chart. I also had another position a little bit closer, about 18 hours before the roll. So I knew within, let's say, 10 nautical miles where I was. Okay. So after I got rid of the mast and I got rid of all the water, I knew approximately where I was, reasonably close. Okay. And I tried to come in, but the current just was taking me to Lord Howe.
It was a huge rescue mission. We had two plane loads of passengers. We have a commercial ship and also the water police out of Sydney. Did you realise how big the operation was to find you and get you back home? Yeah, the commercial line airliner at just 4,000 feet at one stage circling.
Yes, that's right. It all happened very quickly. The people involved, the organisations, the different organisations, it was all coordinated by Canberra. Absolutely fantastic. I was communicating with Canberra every 2 hours. They told me what was going on, what was happening.
Yeah.
They diverted the merchant ship to come out to me. That was even that was a drama because I didn't appear on radar, and I actually had to direct him to me, and he came up and stood by.
And he was part of the rescue. Describe how he was involved in the rescue and how the water police came and got you.
Okay. Very interesting, because without the merchant vessel, the water police would never have found me. Yeah, because I didn't appear on radar, they would never have found me. So the merchant vessel went to my last GPS position, according to the EPIRB, which was some 10 miles away. You see, I was drifting east with this current the whole time. Anyway, he went past me, and I called Canberra, and I said, listen, the merchant ship that you mentioned is here, but they've gone past me. They've gone astern. He said, oh, okay, how can he find you, right? So through Canberra, the merchant ship changed course and they started heading towards me. Because he couldn't see me on radar, he went very, very slowly and just sort of marched down towards me. And eventually they ended up right beside me and they spotted me through the binoculars. And they stood by all night. I spoke to the captain, a very, very wonderful man, with a very warming, calming,
reassuring
outlook, and they stood by, and they were able to give an accurate GPS position to the Sydney Water Police. And during the night, the Water Police could obviously see the merchant ship on their radar, and they steamed straight out there. And then, when it came time to pick me up, they couldn't see me, but the merchant ship was telling them the whole time. The captain of the merchant ship was telling him, listen, he's just like 200 metres from my bow. I was very close to the bow of the merchant ship. It's quite large seas too, I was concerned, but the captain of the merchant ship knew what he was doing with his boat, Very, very professional seaman.
Glenn, did you ever at any time when you're out there think this is it?
Yeah, sure. Sure, yeah. Look, I was in big seas and the waves were going over the boat. I was quite confident everything would be okay until I was picked up by this monster and it just rolled me right over. Look, when the boat fills with water, it tore off the companionway. That's where you go into the boat. When the boat's full of water, you've lost your mast over the side. It's not like the waves end at that moment, you know? It's not like it instantly calms down and the wind stops at that moment. No, it's still ferocious. So of course you think that your number's up.
It's a big ocean, you're out there by yourself, a long way from help.
It's a nasty place, the Tasman Sea.
Indeed it is. Glenn, we're extremely pleased that
you've
made it through.
Thank
your mum and dad are over there in the studio and they've been in tears at getting you back. I can understand that. Well, I can only say congratulations and well done for getting yourself out of a big problem.
Thank you, Ron.
Glenn Eye.
Thank you.
Our missing sailor rescued.